Hi, welcome to Goleta's Community State of the City. My name is Valerie Kushnerov, and I'm the Community Relations Manager and Public Information Officer for the City of Goleta. On behalf of the City Council and staff, we're so pleased that you're here this evening. We'll have a presentation by Mayor Paula Perotti, followed by an overview of the city's finances by Michelle Green, our city manager, and then we'll end with a segment answering your questions about the City of Goleta. When you came in, you should have either been handed a blank card or found one on your seat. Please use this card to write down any questions that you may have for us. Our staff will be collecting these throughout the program, and we will look forward to answering those questions toward the end. Before we dive in, I'd like to introduce our Goleta City Council. We have Mayor Paula Perotti, Mayor Pro Tempore Stuart Kasdan, Councilmember Roger Aceves, Councilmember Michael T. Bennett, and Councilmember Kyle Richards. I would also like to recognize several people and organizations who helped make this event possible. The Goleta Valley Community Center, Scott Phillips from Synergy Computing, the crew from AMS Entertainment, Tony Ruggieri and his team for the video production, Viviana Marsano from Voices Translation and Interpreting Services, and Nothing Bundt Cakes for their delicious treats in the back. If you haven't already gotten one, please feel free to do so. Now, please join me in welcoming Mayor Paula Perotti to the podium.
Thank you, Valerie, and thank you to everyone that's here tonight for our second annual Community State of the City. Let's see, oh, there's a little place to put the water. That's pretty cool. No, maybe not. Okay, so it's my honor, duty, and extreme pleasure to say that the state of the city of Goleta is strong. I'd even say vibrant, vigorous, and vivacious. I'm going to quickly provide some key indicators that this is truly the good land and that we're on a positive upward trajectory. I do want to leave enough time for Michelle Green, our city manager, to provide some additional exciting details. Put my water down. Okay. One of the primary missions of government is to assure the safety of our public. And by all accounts, we are fulfilling this mission quite well. The city of Goleta started off 2018 by being recognized on the National Council list of safest cities in California, the safest in Santa Barbara County. As we welcome Goleta's incoming police chief, Sheriff Lieutenant Grossini, we thank our former chief, Lieutenant Kevin Huddle, for his service. To add to the fire safety in growing West Goleta, our fire station 10 is in the environmental review stage. Staff is working hard to start construction as soon as we have our permit from the California Coastal Commission, which may take some time. When we think of public safety, we also think of our roads, sidewalks, and bike lanes. Things our public works has been busy with. We have completed a $3.9 million of paving projects and expect to do more next year. We completed the Hollister Class 1 multi-purpose path near Elwood School, which received the American Society of Civil Engineers Award. We completed the Ward Drive Class 2 bike lanes. And there are many improvements underway in Old Town, right here in Old Town. We completed a hawk signal at the community center. It's right across the street. If you haven't seen it, you should try it out. That earned the American Public Works Association Award. This is a pedestrian-activated signal to increase pedestrian safety. Public Works has ambitious plans for hawk signals at Hollister and Chapel near the hospital, also Cai Real and Kingston. Magnolia sidewalk improvements have been completed. We also have ongoing efforts on Hollister. The Complete Streets program will make Old Town streets safer for all travel modes and improve the quality of life by making it more appealing to walk, bike, cycle, shop, and dine here. Old Town Sidewalk Project will construct sidewalks on at least one side of all residential streets. And the Bicycle Pedestrian Master Plan that is nearing completion aims to expand and improve the walking and cycling network in the city, making it safer and easier to walk and bike. Another way to reduce traffic and to promote safety is to get cars off the road by using the new peak hour rail service at the Goleta Depot. This is expected to help hundreds of Ventura, Oxnard, Carpinteria commuters get here by train while also freeing up the roads. Planning and Environmental Review Department has also been busy. We received a 3-star community rating for national leadership in sustainability. This reflects our city's progress in these efforts, and we resolve to have 100% renewable energy for all city-owned facilities by 2030. Also in planning, our new director and his team have ambitious plans to finish up projects long in the making. A historical preservation context statement has been circulating and will form the foundation of a historical preservation section for our upcoming zoning ordinance. This will preserve Goleta's historical resources. Our new zoning code will align our zoning with the general plan. Elwood Mesa Habitat Management Plan will protect the Elwood Mesa and Butterfly Preserve and ensure public safety. A cannabis ordinance will tailor Goleta's cannabis growing, processing, and sales of cannabis to new state laws legalizing them. Goleta's new granny units, ADU units, ordinance will tailor Goleta's needs to California's new laws in this area. The electronic permit tracking system will modernize the existing paper system for more efficient and effective staff and public access. Finance. I don't wish to steal Michelle Green's thunder here, except to say that our finances are strong, with record high reserves that should get us through virtually any emergency or downturn. Neighborhood services and recreation. We have several growing opportunities. We have plans to break ground this year in the Old Town Hollister Kellogg Park, long delayed by fighting with the state for ownership. We will be working on addressing needs in 4 parks, Berkeley, Andamar, Winchester 1 and 2, and we will be working with local contractors to upgrade the play equipment at these sites, and we will kick off a parks master plan. We also added permanent pickleball courts at Evergreen Open Space. And later this year, the Monarch Moves program will provide an alternative education experience at Elwood Park for students to learn more about monarch butterflies and highlight this jewel in our community. Negotiations are ongoing as we seek to acquire more Elwood Mesa open space parcels to add to our preserve. Finally, we're on a path to take over management of the Goleta Library starting July 1st of this year. We expect to improve library services while lowering our overall library costs. Staff deserves our thanks for all these achievements, especially in the light of this year's many challenges. We learned that the trees in Elwood Mesa are stressed by the drought and resulting disease, posing potential hazards. While a habitat management study is underway, we have closed some trails but preserved access to the ocean, and we've only removed about 28 trees. The Thomas Fire, Whittier Fire, and Ray Fire affected our entire community in tragic ways. In Goleta, these impacts included the closure of 101 and the threat of flooding in Western Goleta. We got through these due to the significant efforts of our staff. and the Community Emergency Response Team and the Litos Volunteers. We recently honored and recognized 48 Whittier Fire Montecito Mudslide Volunteers from our area who put in over 1,000 hours in disaster relief. We recognize that many challenges and opportunities lie ahead. We are dealing with the impacts of new developments here and at UCSB, especially water and traffic. There is pending litigation that we hope will be favorably and amicably resolved. The Elwood Tree Habitat Management Plan will give us a game plan for what we need to do, but implementing it will pose some fiscal and environmental challenges. We're committed to moving forward to protect the butterfly habitat and provide safe access to the entire Elwood Mesa. Some new staff is still getting settled, and we are looking forward to a new public works director starting at the end of the month. Environmental challenges always loom, such as monitoring and stopping hydrogen sulfide emissions and dealing with possible oil drilling and transportation. The decommissioning of Venico's Elwood onshore facility and piers off Haskell's Beach looms and will need our attention. But we are committed to facing all such challenges head on. Now I want to provide some thoughts on how we can build on our successes and rise to our challenges. As you know, having exceptional personnel is a key part of what we need in order to accomplish our goals. And we're thrilled that for the first time in a long while, we are almost fully staffed. Carmen Nichols joined as our deputy city manager last August. Luke Rio was officially named our finance director in August as well. And Michael Jenkins has been officially named our city attorney, joining Deputy City Attorney Winnie Kai. Peter Imhoff joined us in August as our Director of Planning and Environmental Review. And Allison Gray joined our city as Goleta's first library director. As I mentioned, we will soon have a Director of Public Works on board. We have filled a number of staff positions, bringing us closer to full strength. In addition, after 18 months in office, council members Kasdan and Richards are adding their new energy and ideas to those of our other council members' long experience. This new team positions us to turn the page for a new and even brighter future. Some of you may know that before I was elected to City Council, I was very active in the Parent Teacher Association, the PTA. I focused on safe routes to schools, successfully lobbying for reduced speed limits around schools, because we know speed kills. Our motto for keeping children safe was stop, look, and listen. And I've been thinking that stop, look, and listen would be a great mantra for the city of Goleta in the coming years. Stop. We've added over 1,000 new housing units in Goleta in just a few years. Many supported such housing to help our local employers recruit workers. But new housing units alone do not attract and keep workers. Potential recruits, new workers, and current residents expect and deserve the high quality of life Goleta has offered, especially key services. It's now time to stop and deal with the impacts of recent cumulative growth. We need to make sure that we can provide key services such as road capacity, water, libraries, parking, recreation, and safe pedestrian and bicycling options for all of our residents. But I'd like you to please note very carefully, I'm not saying that we can or should stop all growth. I think we all can agree our residents want carefully managed, sustainable growth that is appropriate not just to the letter, but also to the spirit of the general plan. But at the same time, we must make sure we grow only at the rate that deals with the resulting impacts, so that the character of Goleta is enhanced, not eroded. Goleans made this clear last election by voting in Council Members Kasdan and Richards, who both ran on better pacing the rate of growth. Since they were elected, no new large projects have been approved. Now for the look, and stop, look, and listen. What do I mean by look? It means we need to look. Actually, physically, literally, look at Goleta and make sure we like what we see. We need to work on the visual aspects of Goleta, protecting our environment, our ocean and mountain views, maintaining appropriate setbacks and landscape, and generally making sure that our neighborhoods, public spaces, and thoroughfares are places we want to see. And by look, I also mean that we need to keep our eyes on the future. We need to envision how we can leave Goleta better for those who will live here in the decades to come. This includes providing a needed infrastructure such as a permanent city hall and an upgraded community center. It includes preparing to prevent and respond to natural disasters, such as the recent fires, floods, and mudslides. It includes adopting sustainable practices to provide enough water, safeguard our crown jewels, such as the Elwood Preserve, and doing our part to address climate change. Finally, we have to listen. We need to listen better to each other, to our staff, to our local businesses and workers, and all our residents of all ages. As you may know, we recently formed a 7-member public engagement commission made up of a diverse group of Goletans. They are tasked with making recommendations on how to gain greater participation from our entire community. Not just a few advocacy groups, not just a few interest groups, but everyone. So in the coming year, I'm going to stop, look, and listen. And I encourage us all to do the same. It's not just the safe way forward, it's the best way we can protect, preserve, and enhance all that is great about this good land. I hope you will join me and take the time to stop, look, and listen for an even better city of Goleta. Thank you.
Thank you, Mayor Perotti, for those remarks. It's always great to know that our city is vivacious and vibrant. It's now my privilege to introduce our city manager, Michelle Green, who will give a little more information on the city's financial outlook.
Good evening, everyone. I'm pleased to present the City of Goleta's financial outlook to you tonight. We're approaching the midpoint of the city's 2-year budget and are in the process of adjusting our forecast to meet the city's needs over the coming fiscal year. Ensuring that the city has the resources to meet its obligations is critical. To do this, we look at past revenue trends, reserve funds, and other economic indicators to forecast the city's fiscal health. And tonight, the city's financial outlook remains very positive. And over the past 16 years, its revenue base has increased steadily. As you'll see in the following slides, our revenues have risen primarily due to increased transient occupancy tax, better known as TOT, sales tax, and property tax, which together make up 85% of the city's total revenues. TOT leads the top three at 36%, while sales tax and property tax come in at 25% and 26% or 24% respectively. The following chart shows in dollars what the top three generators contribute to the city's revenue stream. TOT revenues were $8.6 million for fiscal year 16-17 and have climbed to a projected $9.2 million for the current fiscal year. This projection reflects an increase in TOT revenue due to the recent opening of both the Marriott Residence Inn and the Hilton Garden Inn. Additionally, occupancy during December and January was up last year, in part because of the Thomas Fire and debris flow events. As a result, TOT revenue was 59% higher in January than the prior year. And we're really grateful that Goleta's hoteliers were able to extend generous rates to our neighbors in need during this very difficult time. Sales tax experienced an increase as well, going from $6.5 million in fiscal year 16-17 to a projected $6.6 million by the end of the current fiscal year. Despite this growth in sales tax, the city remains conservative in its projections for future years. We're still seeing the impact of online sales on our traditional brick and mortar retailers, especially last December when all that smoke and ash kept shoppers at home and inside. A change in the retail landscape means shifts in sales tax allocations, and the city's carefully monitoring these fluctuations as it projects future revenues. Property tax is expected to increase slightly this year, rising to about $6.5 million. This can be attributed in part to the increase in assessed valuations that have occurred through recent significant sales transactions within city limits. It's critical for the city's fiscal stability that we maintain a balanced budget and a healthy contingency reserve, while also meeting the community's various needs. And I'm pleased to say that the city's budget is structurally balanced, with projected revenues for the current fiscal year at $25.7 million and projected expenditures at $24.8 million. In addition, the general fund is projected to close out the year with an unobligated fund balance of $1.2 million. But more importantly, the City Council's prudent reserve policies and careful planning have resulted in a healthy contingency reserve, which is projected to be over $8 million by the end of the current fiscal year. In addition to these positive revenue projections and our healthy reserve and fund balance, there are other indicators which reflect a healthy local economy for those who live and work in Goleta. The unemployment rate is currently at 3.9%, and the Federal Reserve considers a base unemployment rate of 5% to 5.2% as full employment, so we're doing really well here. In addition, Goleta's unemployment rate is currently lower than any other of the cities in Santa Barbara County, and we'd like to keep it that way. In the area of commercial real estate, Goleta currently has vacancy rates of 8.8% for office space, which is a sizable decrease from last year, 2.2% for retail space, which is about the same as the previous year, and 3.3% for industrial space. The office market in 2018 has already seen the vacancy rate drop to 7.8% with the recent leasing of a 60,000 square foot space not far from here in Old Town. Additionally, the office rate is expected to be at 5% in the second quarter, which is a level that we haven't seen in Goleta since 2006. So that's very significant. So as you leave here later on tonight, I hope you'll remember this. The state of our city is very positive. Our city council and staff are closely monitoring revenues, expenditures, and critical economic indicators. We're working to enhance our reserve funds so we can have the resources available to deliver projects and serve our community better. We hope you'll engage with us as we continue to work for the benefit of Goleta. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Green, for that important financial review. Now we'd like to give you the opportunity to ask your questions. I'd like to ask Mayor Perotti and the management team to join me on the stage. While they're doing that, please raise your hand if you have a question card that needs to be collected or if you need a card and to ask your question. So I'm going to introduce this distinguished group. On the end, we have our interim public works directors, Masood Mahood and Bob Woodward. We have Todd Mitchell, who's our HR and risk manager, Luke Rio, our finance director, Winnie Kai, our deputy city attorney, and Carmen Nichols, our deputy city manager, Peter Imhoff, our planning and environmental review director, Allison Gray, who is our newest management team member as the new director of the library, Vito Adamidis, who's our neighborhood services and public safety director, and obviously Michelle Green, our city manager, and Mayor Paula Perotti. And I'm not sure if Charlie Ebling got a chance to duck in. He's here in the back. He's going to be on the hot seat next year when we do the community state of the city. He's our new public works director who will join us at the end of the month. So become familiar with that face. Okay, so now I'm going to go through these cards and we'll have the appropriate staff member come up or the mayor and answer them. And feel free if you have another question to raise your hand and we'll continue to collect them. So, Peter, I suspect this one's for you. What is the policy of the city about garage conversion, short-term rental numbers, and is there a limit of renters allotted on individual homes? I'll give you the card, because that'll be three questions in one.
Thank you, good evening. I'll see if I can answer that a little bit. Sound back. On garage conversions, we're in the process right now of developing an accessory dwelling unit or ADU ordinance, a granny unit ordinance, that will regulate conversions of garages, among other things, to second units. And under state law, that's something that's now allowable in all residential zones, so that's something we can expect to see more of. And it is legally permissible. There are certain requirements, of course, including certain parking requirements, but that you'll be hearing more about that soon. We anticipate bringing our draft accessory dwelling unit ordinance, which has been through a workshop process at our planning commission, back to the planning commission in the next month, and then on to our city council. So you can expect more about that. Let's see, I'll take the last question. Is there a limit of renters allowed on individual homes? No, not that I'm aware of. I don't think that there's any limit at this point on individual homes. That's something that is regulated strictly between the property owner and the lessee. And short-term rentals is something that that is also regulated under ordinance. So I think I'll stop there.
You can stay here. I'll read the next question. Sorry, that's not yours. Is development, actually this is not yours either. This is probably a question you can answer. Why so many new housings are cramped into small plots? I start feeling like I'm living in an anthill. Maybe you can talk about the densities.
Thank you. So that's a really good question. Of course, the city of Goleta is actually a very diverse built environment, and the densities that are allowed are regulated fundamentally under our general plan. So there are wonderful lower density suburban areas that are at about 4 units per acre. And then there are also areas, some of the newer developments that are at higher densities. So there really are a mix of different housing types for different needs. Increasingly, trends show that with an aging population and with millennials coming of age, there is a demand for smaller units and more units on a lot. We also fundamentally have to respond to state regulation that requires us to absorb a certain amount of growth on a regular basis on an 8-year cycle through the so-called regional housing needs allocation process. That is a challenging process for many jurisdictions, and in the future, we will have to do our part and think about how to absorb that allocated growth in ways that protect community character and that also address the fundamental growth share that we're accorded through a regional planning process. So that's just a fundamental fact of life, and that in California, and that is something that will deserve a lot of attention and a lot of thoughtful discussion about how we do that in the future.
One more for you for the moment. How will the city of Goleta prevent the negative impact of legal marijuana from causing problems for residents? That might be a multi-pronged answer.
So thank you. These are really good questions, and these are very topical questions. The question of cannabis regulation is something that we're grappling with right now. We have been working on a draft ordinance for the past several months. After going through a workshop process before our planning commission, we invite and encourage input and participation in that process because this is a new use and a new industry in California that was made legal under Prop 64 and that many jurisdictions are still learning how to grapple with. So there are a lot of questions about how those new uses will affect the city of Goleta. Under the proposed ordinance as it's drafted now, outdoor cultivation for commercial purposes would not be allowed. Only indoor cultivation would be permitted. There is a provision in state law that allows a certain small number of plants to be grown by individuals outdoors, and we have certain regulations with respect to distance from property boundaries for that kind of cultivation. The other way in which cannabis uses can directly affect the public is really through retail sales. And retail sales is something that we want to hear more about from the public on, but the way that the ordinance is drafted now, it would provide for setbacks, significant setbacks, a minimum of 600 feet from sensitive receptors, including schools, and between retail outlets as well. And just because of the configuration of the Goleta landscape, the many schools in Goleta, and the limitations on commercial zoned areas, there will be a de facto limitation on the number of retail distributors. And of course, that could be capped or further limited by our city council as this moves forward. So there's a lot of flexibility in how we regulate that, and it is certainly ripe for discussion.
Thank you. So Vito, you're up next. There are a couple questions on the status of Fire Station 10. So can you expand on where that process is?
Good evening. The status of Fire Station 10, we are making good progress in moving that project forward. Right now, staff is completing their internal review of the administrative draft EIR document and draft environmental impact report document. Once those edits have been completed, the EIR will be released to the public for comment for a 45-day period. So we're looking forward to that. Between now and the next several months, we'll be back in front of the city's design review board to get some further input and to provide then some feedback from our first meeting that we had last year in front of the DRB where they gave us some input. We also expect to be in front of the Planning Commission and also City Council for some land use issues, general plan amendments and rezones for the fire station. As we prepare for the submittal of the application to the California Coastal Commission. So we expect that to happen this year. So we're looking forward to seeing this important project move forward through the process and help make all of Goleta and particularly Western Goleta a safer place with addressing the fire deficiency that's on the west side of Goleta, which has been there. Really going back now, we're talking about the original idea and need that was identified for a fire station going back to 1967. So we don't think it's going to take that long going forward to complete this, I assure you. But we are making very good progress in seeing that project come forward.
Thank you. This is a comment related to public safety as well. Dangerous speeds on Hollister west of Elwood School. So I'll pass that one along to you to share with the public safety, unless you'd like to comment.
So public safety is one of the important priorities of the City Council and of the city. We have the largest motor unit in the contract cities across the county. We have 4 motor officers. We respond to complaints from the community on a daily basis. So if you have a speed concern anywhere in the city, be it in your neighborhood or near a school, we're happy to respond. And we'll be happy to look into this concern of the speeds on Hollister west of Elwood School. Particularly, people need to understand that around schools, they need to slow down. And that's where we have our motor officers who have various types of equipment, including radar and LIDAR equipment that detects your speed. We also conduct throughout the year a number of traffic safety efforts, including DUI checkpoints, crosswalk enforcement, where people who are trying to cross a crosswalk, the motorists need to stop for people coming through a crosswalk because we want it to be safe. So all this in the effort of making Goleta a safe place for everybody.
This next question is, what is the status of the San Jose Creek lawsuit? Who would like to do that one?
Deputy City Attorney Winnie Kai here. We do not have a lawsuit, any litigation surrounding San Jose Creek. They mean the Department of Finance, right, Jaime? Okay. So the city of Goleta has a lawsuit with the state of California over some funds that were used by the city's former redevelopment agency that was used to fund basically the fixing of San Jose Creek in the last few years. And that litigation is ongoing, and but we're also working very hard with the state to try to come to a settlement of the issues, and we've also made some pretty good progress in the last few months. Settlement talks are continuing, and we hope to have something good to report to the community about that soon.
This next question is for Public Works. Can you address or talk about the proposed 101 overpass at Entrance Road, the one in Western Goleta?
Good evening, Bob Woodward, Interim Public Works Director. To the question on the 101 overcrossing, the project study report, which is basically a draft report which is prepared for Caltrans, which goes through the different alignment alternatives, has been prepared. We're currently in discussions with Caltrans regarding formalizing their review of that document. This is the first step in the process of beginning the environmental review. The environmental review will look at all the different alternatives. Currently, we have 3 alternatives that we're considering. Those will, once we have Caltrans approval of the PSR, we will move forward with the environmental review. So that's the status at this point. There has been some outreach to some of the property owners that are going to be having some surveys done on their property as part of the environmental review. So there has been some limited outreach in that regard. Once we are able to get the project on par with Caltrans in terms of their review, there will be a little more outreach once the environmental process actually starts.
So if you'll stay, there's part 2. What is the evidence that justifies the building of an overcrossing bridge near 101 freeway in the Elwood area?
There has long been an interest in completing connections between the southern part of Goleta and the northern part of Goleta, and basically adding another point of connection north to south. Right now, the primary travel routes to go from north to south in Goleta are the Stork Glen Annie overcrossing, and then you have to go all the way down to the Cathedral Oaks interchange. There is nothing in between those two points. Going back to county days, there was an interest in doing a pedestrian overcrossing. That was initially proposed by county. As we looked at the growth in vehicle circulation and bike ped circulation, it was decided that we would go with a hybrid bridge, which would have a combination of ped bike and vehicle capability. This is important in terms of funding, because Measure A, which is where we are getting our funding for the overcrossing, requires a multimodal connection. So the justification is really adding one more north-south connecting corridor. It helps reduce the emergency response times, reduce congestion at the Stork Glen Annie interchange, which, as most of you know, it gets pretty extensive at some points, as well as being able to get kids to school a little bit more efficiently.
One more question for you. What percent of the population of the city of Goleta actually uses bike lanes? Bike lanes cause traffic to increase the chance of an accident. Try to avoid unsafe cyclists.
We have just completed a draft bike ped master plan that is examining all of these implications of bike and ped traffic. I don't have the exact percentage tonight, but the intention is to encourage different modes of travel, including recreational cycling as well as commuting cycling. Traditionally, our culture here in Southern California has been one of a vehicle-dominated culture, and obviously we prefer to encourage different modes of people getting where they're going, healthier modes, and to the safety concern, obviously there's an ongoing effort to train cyclists in safe biking. Starts from the earliest age. We've seen the training going on with the Elwood School and some of the younger kids. And obviously that training will continue as more and more people are riding. But it is a mode of transportation we're encouraging. And all riders and drivers, obviously safety is always a consideration.
Thank you. That's it for now. How did the Hilton Garden Inn get approved? It ruined the views of our beautiful mountains and is an ugly structure. Partnered with that, why does the Hilton have such a radiant red sign? I think that's you, Peter.
I guess that's another one for me. With any development of that size and scale, there's a lengthy process that the development application goes through. Through hearings before our Planning Commission and our City Council, and there's a lot of opportunity for public input. Of course, there's also design review, and we have a design review board that reviews those projects. There are a lot of different opinions about the Hilton Garden Inn, I'm sure, but it was something that went through this lengthy process and reached a result where the community and our council at the time did support that. Going forward, we are gonna be looking especially at our design review process to try to right size that process. That's something that we're considering right now. I had the privilege to work at Santa Barbara County very closely with their architectural review board for many years, and I have deep respect for the role of design review boards and architectural review. There's a flexibility there and a sensitivity to things like neighborhood character and scale that you don't get out of a rigid zoning code. So that's something that we need to strengthen to some degree and right size, and that's something that I'll be paying a lot of attention to and working on with our staff to make sure we get that right.
Another hotel question for you. This question is expressing concern about the three-story hotel proposed to be built on Cai Real. Can you provide a brief update on how this will fit into the neighborhood?
Sure. That's a project application that has just been deemed complete at the city level, so we're at the very outset of our process, and we'll be going through a discretionary process, including design review and opportunity for a lot of public input on that process. So it remains to be seen how the process shapes that project. I've neglected to mention in connection with the Hilton Garden Inn question, but it's equally applicable here, that there's also, of course, a review process under the California Environmental Quality Act, under CEQA. So that provides another level of protection and of information so that we and the public can understand what the effects of a particular project are. And I look forward to working with Planning Commission, our council, and all of you to shepherd these kind of projects through our process so that we get a result that the community is comfortable with and of course that meets the general plan land use designation and the zoning. So in California, there is a lot of opportunity for input, and it really depends on the input and participation of the community to ensure that what goes through the process is something that we're all happy with.
I'm not sure if anyone here will have something to share on this because it's really a City of Santa Barbara question, but why is it that the airport is changing or adding to their flights? Is the Winchester Canyon and Elwood, in Winchester Canyon and Elwood, Galitans are affected as early as 5:30 in the morning. The noise is also an issue. Is there someone that can answer, have any insight?
I can't provide the answer for the changes to the flights, but I would direct whomever had that question to the airport director, Hazel Johns. She and her staff have a multitude of information about the flight schedule, the impacts. They're very anxious to hear any complaints about noise and other impacts. They want to hear from you. They want to hear from the Goleta community. They also know a lot about the airline regulations and the regulations that pilots have to work under. So I really encourage anyone who has concerns, questions, and especially complaints, please reach out to the City of Santa Barbara, Hazel Johns, because they want to hear from you. They want to be responsive to the community. So that's the information I have.
Okay, what are the plans for regulating the number of vehicles associated with long-term rentals?
Good evening again. So the only way in which the number of vehicles are regulated for any kind of rentals is through the number of parking spaces that are required under the zoning. So the number of vehicles per se is not regulated unless there is some kind of a nuisance condition on the parcel where there are junked cars or inoperable cars. But normally, most residential dwelling units under our zoning code require 2 spaces per unit. So typically, whether you're talking about a single family residence or you're talking about apartments, there will be 2 spaces associated with that unit required by our zoning. And that's really the only way in which we regulate vehicles. It's through parking.
This card says how less trash. So I'm not sure what the question is. But if you will talk to our public works directors after to provide a little more clarification, our solid waste contract comes under public works and we'd be happy to answer that. Has there been any interest in changing the city name to Goleta Beach? There has been interest, but I'm not sure that it's come from the city. And it hasn't had any traction in the last few years that I'm aware of, but if someone else would like to answer that.
Just to reiterate what Valerie has just said, basically, we haven't heard of any recent interest, so we've not brought that question to our council. But if that does become something that the community is interested in, feel free to contact my office or one of our council members or our mayor, and we can take a look at that possible change. But at the moment, it's really not on our radar.
So these next two questions are about trees. The Public Tree Commission spent many hours writing guidelines for heritage trees, a process for nominating and naming trees. So why is the Planning Department trying to make an end run around the work that was done? They proposed new public hearing for heritage trees while writing heritage ordinance. Why is staff not using the work the council has already adopted?
I think this question relates to our historic preservation ordinance, which is underway now. We have a historic context statement that was released, and a lot of attention and work was done to that. In addition to looking at the history of structures in our area, looking at cultural resources, including back to our long Chumash tradition, the historic context statement also looks at heritage trees, and it doesn't do that without regard to prior work that has been done or our Uniform Tree Protection Plan or Forest Protection Plan. It does it in context with that. And so any ordinance that results out of this process, a historic preservation ordinance, would consciously be synced with other work that has been done in the past. And I've heard this comment previously in our review of the context statement. We did take it to heart, and we look forward to paying attention to that as we go forward in our process.
Trees at Stowgrove Park and Lake Los Carneros are dying. Can't they be taken care of or watered?
The trees that most of you will have seen, maybe all of you will have seen by now, that are distressed are redwood trees. They are not native to this part of California. For many years, they were thriving because of what we used to think of as normal rainfall rates during the winter months. But as we all know, we've suffered many years now of severe drought. Those redwood trees can't take the higher temperatures and the lower humidity in the air. We do water them. We have a program where they're getting extra watering at the root base of the tree. We've also tried watering them through spraying up into the canopy to replicate the type of humidity that they really need to be healthy. Unfortunately, the higher temps that we're experiencing, the lower rainfall rates, the lower humidity really are the challenges we're facing that we can't make enough of an impact on to keep those trees from being stressed. And once they are stressed, they become very vulnerable to disease and pests. So we are doing everything we can to trim them, maintain them, put extra water on them, but it is incredibly difficult to fight Mother Nature, especially with a species that may be native in California, but not in that particular area. So we don't want to lose the trees. We're trying to save as many as we can. They won't all make it, unfortunately. And that's a really sad thing. They're part of the identity of that neighborhood and the history of our community. We do have experts that we rely on, arborists who we've worked with. We've gotten several different opinions to make sure that we're getting the right guidance and consistent guidance, and we'll continue to work with those specialists to see what we can do for those trees. And like I said, save the ones we can. So the best thing for them is really cooler temps, higher humidity, and a whole lot more rain. That will give them the chance they need to thrive. At the same time, we are also looking at options for fighting those pests in ways that are environmentally not harmful to other plants, to humans, to animals. So that's an area we're looking to see if there's more that we can do besides maintenance and pruning and watering. So stay tuned for that. And that's it.
So we have a third question on trees. How are you working with helping the distressed eucalyptus trees in Elwood Mesa? It's the hot seat for you.
This is one of the most challenging and important topics that we're grappling with right now. A crisis began really last summer when some 20% of the 5,000-odd trees on Elwood Mesa were identified as under stressed conditions, either dead or dying eucalyptus trees. That grove, of course, provides, in addition to a wonderful open space and a recreational resource for the community, sensitive habitat for the monarch butterfly and for other species. So it's a very delicate issue, and we are presently in the process now of developing an approach to deal with that. We have a draft monarch butterfly habitat management plan that we're putting the final touches on and that we'll be bringing forward to council. Our city council did grapple with this issue a couple times over the last year. Last fall, it approved the removal of 28 dead trees, and we have sought earlier this year approval for removal of a similar number of additional trees that are dead or dying and that were threatening either pathways or neighboring property owners. So what the community has asked for before we move forward with any more removal of dead trees is an understanding of what the overall game plan is, how we will deal with restoration, and how we'll deal with the long-term management of this habitat in a way that is sustainable and protects these resources. So more process ahead, stay tuned. This is another area where public participation will be very valuable and important.
Is development driven by the need for property tax revenue as a result of the revenue neutrality agreement?
Okay, Peter and I are going to share this question. I just want to state that no, development isn't driven by a sense that the city needs to make up property tax revenues because of the fact that 50% of what's generated in Goleta in property tax goes to the county. We would love to have that entire 100%, but at this point, we're not able to obtain that. But we do not look at our budget and our bottom line and make decisions about development based on revenues. And then Peter has a few things to add.
I would just echo that answer and say an emphatic no. From my perspective as a planning director and looking at things from the framework and through the lens of planning, that is something that we do not consider at all. Fiscalization of land use is a derogatory term in planning circles and something that is not regarded as within the framework of how we look at questions of land use and questions of what development can occur. Fundamentally, again, the roadmap for development in any city, but certainly in the city of Goleta, is our general plan that's adopted, and that governs what can be built where. We have a zoning code that implements that. We're working now on an update of that zoning code, which will be very important in the actual implementation of the general plan, but that is what drives development, and the process of developing and amending our general plan and our zoning has nothing to do with the revenue that's generated from development that occurs.
This card reads, Goleta Valley Junior High has allowed a charter school to use their facilities. Younger children scream all day long, especially during the summer. This morning, the kids were yelling at 6 a.m. Who allows this and how can you fight it? The quick and easy answer is you would need to contact the Santa Barbara Unified School District because they're allowing the charter school or whomever is doing the activities on their property to exist. So contact them. It's not something the city of Goleta regulates. This next question is, can the city of Goleta join President Trump's lawsuit against California's illegal and unconstitutional sanctuary state policies? The city council chooses whether or not to take a position on issues outside of the city. So if a majority of council members decided they wanted to take that up, they could certainly pass a resolution of that nature. First, big congrats on the new building and look in Goleta. My question, I know that Goleta is known for being Santa Barbara's dumping grounds. What will you do as our mayor next time to make sure other cities do not dump on our beach toxin feces for the next disaster? And how can we, the Goleta citizen, help you ensure they do not dump on Goleta Beach or freeways?
Well, during the tragic mudslides that we had in Montecito, it was pretty horrible. And I know that the county in the past, they received a permit from the Coastal Commission to be able to dump on Goleta Beach, and they have in the past. The problem that I see is that maybe we needed to be a little bit more involved, the city. City of Goleta, we do not have ownership, or it's not in our jurisdiction, the Goleta Beach, but it is our beach. Our families go to that beach. That's our beach. So we care very deeply about that beach. And we have had ongoing meetings with the county officials to see if in the future, just because we've always dumped, they've dumped debris there, in the future, might we look at other locations that it would be able to be used? And I mean, right now, our beach is still closed, and it's the only beach that's closed. So this is it's interesting that you bring this up, because today, Michelle Green, city manager, and myself were just talking about this and hoping to have a meeting with our county officials again to reevaluate when another disaster happens. Let's take a look at where else that this mud or debris can be located as well. We very much wanted to share in helping with the disaster. But as we see now, we're not quite sure when our beach will open, and summer's coming. And so, yes, we will be having another conversation with the county and see if we can collaborate with them and see what we can do moving forward. Thank you.
This question reads, why is the city going to spend money on traffic circles and narrowing Hollister rather than fixing streets we already have? So I think you want information on the Hollister Complete Streets project and the Equal Fowler roundabouts. And if that's not what you meant, these two gentlemen are the ones to ask afterwards.
In the ever-changing academy of streets and roadways, they're always looking for better ways to move people around. Some of these, like roundabouts, are somewhat unusual in traditional American driving venues, but they become more and more common. And I think little by little, people are learning to drive on them. In certain volumes of vehicles moving, they can be a way to keep traffic moving without so much stop and start. Most of the carbon monoxide and PM10 particulate pollution and this type of thing tends to come from stopping and starting. So to the extent that you can keep traffic moving is ideal. But you know, we're always looking at newer, more creative ways to integrate new travel modes, concepts of moving people around, keeping things moving efficiently. And you know, Goleta's has always been a pretty innovative place, and we're seeing a lot of that, and we're developing concepts for our Complete Streets program as well.
What is the status of the LED streetlight conversion? Sorry, I almost said, I think.
I'm just gonna stay up here.
So the city's been in the process of acquiring about 12 to 1300 street lights from Southern California Edison. The current process is making its way through the California Public Utilities Commission, and at some point the city is going to be acquiring those street lights and retrofitting them with a lower wattage type bulb. These are LED bulbs. The transfer of the streetlights is a program that Edison offers. It allows the cities to have a little bit better of a control over their own streetlights. It's an energy saver for the city's budget, and the city is looking to realize some fairly significant benefits from that. So the timetable, we're still some time out from actually acquiring the streetlights, but that process is in progress, and we will be providing some updates as we get through the Public Utilities Commission and are looking to make that final acquisition.
So just stay here. This comment says, the Hawk light still doesn't stop cars coming here tonight. Light was red and three cars crossed to turn into the community center. Why would you put this type of light in when you could use a regular person activated light that drivers will obey? No difference in stoppage of through traffic.
The process of people stopping for red lights is one which is typically enforced by the by our motor units. So in terms of moving people across streets, we, you know, are obviously looking for more innovative ways of doing that. Traditional lights tend to bring people to a complete stop, just like another signal. Pedestrian activated beacons are really only activated when pedestrians are present. The level of signaling is actually better than you get with most street lights. Because of the mast arms, the visibility is better. There's a bit of a learning curve that goes along with that. I think getting people to understand that that a crosswalk is a stop in any case, whether it has a street light or not, is often an ongoing education thing with most drivers. But we'll certainly work with enforcement in terms of making sure people are coming to a stop when they see the red light.
So Luke, I think this is for you. What is considered an acceptable reserve for a city of our size, and how is it calculated?
Good evening. Thank you for asking that finance question. So city reserve policies are set by city council. There are also best practices for local governments. The city of Goleta tends to follow best practices established by the Government Finance Officers Association. They recommend that cities have a minimum of about 16%, so roughly about 2 months, 2.5 months of reserve set aside. The city of Goleta has a contingency reserve policy that sets aside 33% of the city's general fund operating budget. So every city is different. Every city has different priorities. They operate differently. Their revenue sources are different. It all depends on the cash flow needs, the expenditure needs, and the projects the cities are undertaking. So we do review these reserves on an annual basis, and they're reported to city council and the public on a quarterly basis. I feel right now we do have a strong reserve policies, and they have helped us get us, remain fiscally healthy and strong. And so that's always a positive thing. Thank you.
There are several people that can answer this question as it impacts most departments within the city. Why is the city of Goleta not putting more money into Old Time, making it as such as one would like to visit and hang out? Don't all jump at once.
I'll do it.
I'm not quite sure what, I mean, I would love to talk to whoever wrote that, because I think we are putting a lot of money into Old Town. We're trying to, we're working on the sidewalk program, sidewalk project. We're improving, you know, we're looking at complete streets, which will identify how to make the area on Hollister safer for all cars and bicyclists and pedestrians that will want to come here and spend time here instead of just driving through here. So, see, I'm trying to think of some of the other projects. Do you want to say something? Oh, okay.
Good evening. We also want to share with all of you that Hollister Kellogg Park, as was previously mentioned by the mayor at the very beginning of this presentation tonight, Hollister Kellogg Park is scheduled to come before the City Council in May, on May 1st, for the award of contract for construction. This is the first ever neighborhood park designed from the ground up that will include some wonderful amenities for Old Town. Old Town and the residents of Old Town have asked for a community park for as long as I can remember. And this project is now coming to fruition, and we're excited about seeing this come to Old Town. It'll be a place for all age groups to come and visit and enjoy. It'll include also a skate park component. We will have all kinds of amenities for people to enjoy the park. And as many of you know, parks really contribute to the quality of life. And when you see a park like this come to Old Town, it's going to be a great opportunity to share with the community and to have really a treasure in Old Town for all of the residents to enjoy. We're also looking at, in helping to make Old Town a better place, a couple of other things. We've been working with the council and the council's public safety subcommittee to deal with parking restrictions in Old Town to help make it a better place for people to come to as a destination. So we're reviewing now the results of a community survey and continuing to work with the Department of Public Works in looking at the restrictions that would go along Hollister so you could have time parking so people who are coming to do business or coming to visit the businesses on Hollister will actually have a place to be able to park. Because we've heard parking and the complaints of not enough parking or that cars are being parked for long periods of time on Hollister, this will be dealt with more effectively. We also have, in an effort to protect neighborhoods, a full-time parking enforcement officer who responds to complaints on a daily basis throughout Old Town. And these complaints primarily deal with vehicles that don't move or appear to be abandoned. So for your information, a vehicle that's parked on the street for more than 72 hours without moving is in violation of city code. So if you have one of those vehicles in your neighborhood, we're happy to respond to it. You can see me after the meeting and I can provide you more information about how we do that. But what happens is when you file a complaint, the parking officer goes out and tags the vehicle and checks it in 72 hours after it's been tagged. Once that vehicle has been tagged and he comes back and it's still there 72 hours later, that vehicle gets towed, it gets removed. So these are efforts to provide amenities to Old Town, the park, Hollister Kellogg Park, which we're really excited about seeing come to the community, as well as helping to protect our neighborhoods in dealing with the issue of abandoned or inoperative vehicles.
Let me add my two cents. We'll do our tag team interdepartmentally here. You know, there's a lot in the planning process as well for Old Town. You know, the Complete Streets process and program is looking at ways to kind of revitalize the way people move through Old Town in terms of bike lanes, pedestrian travel, vehicle movement, and really kind of setting the tone for the backbone or the infrastructure of Old Town. It's hard to plan for where all of the other improvements are going to go until you look at how people get in and out and through Old Town. So the Complete Streets project is looking at that. It's currently in the planning stages. So the next stage is to begin to implement concepts. But there's a whole process that's going on now in terms of meetings, discussions, and planning to look at how to do that better. Additionally, there's historically been issues with flooding in Old Town. The process that we're going through with some of the flood control improvements we've completed, as well as looking at master planning our storm drain system and looking at a complete master plan of drainage, will also begin to identify areas where we can make drainage improvements, which will reduce some of the flooding people are seeing. So step by step, we are looking to make some improvements to Old Town, but it is the oldest part of town, and obviously we want to be respectful as we're doing it, so we're taking a step-by-step approach to it.
We also have the Old Town Sidewalks Project, which will create sidewalks on the north side of Hollister, between Hollister and the freeway in Old Town, and that's currently underway. Last year, we launched the Beautify Goleta program, which primarily occurred in Old Town last year, and that was the opportunity for residents to dispose of trash in large bins that Marburg provided. It was a Saturday event where people could come in and clean up some of the trash they had in their yards, or just to make Old Town look a little bit nicer. We are continuing that program throughout the city, but that's another initiative in Old Town specifically. We do have an Old Town email and text notification list where every month we send an update on things that are happening within Old Town, because you can see every department in City Hall touches Old Town in some way, and there's a great interest in making Old Town vibrant for our community. So I'm going to read this card. I'm not sure what the question is here, so if you can come up and talk with staff, we'd be happy to address it. It says 2.2% at vacancy, community-owned retail business rental rates impacts of 2.2%. So I apologize if I'm not reading that correctly, but please feel free to come up afterwards and let us know what your question is. Has a house of worship been approved for property near the Los Carneros roundabout at Cai Real? Yes, I believe that's called the Islamic Center, and that is well underway. Two more questions that I have. If there's anyone else that has a question, please flag down staff and we'll be happy to get to it. Traffic engineers have promised everything a new project was. Let me see what. I apologize. Traffic engineers have promised everything a new project was voted on that impacts could be mitigated. Obviously, that was not the case. What is the city doing to implement penalties if a project negatively affects traffic?
Hello again. The project process, the approval process, is really front-loaded, so the analysis happens during the review phase of a project to understand what the traffic impacts of a project would be, and a traffic study is typically prepared. That traffic study identifies the number of trips that a project would generate, and then fees are assessed, impact fees under our Goleta Transportation Improvement Program, that are used to implement solutions that offset the effects of traffic. After a project is approved, really the gates are closed and we don't have a way to check and see whether trips are in fact what was anticipated through the study. But usually the modeling that goes into the traffic analysis is very good and fairly accurate, and we have a good sense of what the traffic impacts will be for any given project.
Is there any discussion about bringing art to Goleta, such as art walks, space for artists, museums, etc.? Thanks.
Well, I think we are looking at moving forward and doing more community events and art. I know we don't have any projects in the works right now, other than I've heard of a mural project that might be happening in Old Town, but it's something that I know is important to the full council. We have expressed our desire to really pursue the arts and have more arts in our city, as well as community events. So it's something that we as a council will be moving forward and looking at.
Was street cleaning studied prior to? Who is responsible to start and fortunately stopped it?
So the city streets do get cleaned on a regular basis throughout city limits in all of our neighborhoods. So we do have two separate services that provide street sweeping. Part of it is accomplished through a contract the city has with a vendor, and then Goleta West Sanitary District pays for sweeping services within the western end of Goleta. So we do have sweeping. We do not have restricted parking on street sweeping days. The sweepers do what they can to work around parked cars. That may be something that the city council will want to reevaluate in the future. But at this stage, we are doing monthly sweeping without parking restrictions. So I hope that answered the question, but that's really it.
This is the last question I have for the mayor and or city manager. Of all the topics you have raised today, what do you see as a single biggest opportunity or challenge that Goleta faces over the rest of 2018, and how can we help?
That's a great question. I think one of the a challenge that we have, I think Peter Imhoff, our planning director, identified the need to really figure out what we're doing with the Elwood Mesa Preserve and you know, the butterfly preserve, and you know, the butterfly symbol is our identity. It's on our logo. It's everywhere. So, you know, to have that devastation hit that area, we are working on a management plan, but it's going to take work and time and resources, a lot of resources, to make it work. So I would hope that the community has been really engaged. I would continue to hope that you will stay engaged with that process. And also, as I said in my speech, another thing, you know, we need to look at is we've built a lot of homes and there's been a lot of development, and what are those impacts from that development? And we need to take a step back and look at the cumulative effect of it, and can we still provide the key services that we're all used to and deserve here in Goleta? So I think that's something that will, you know, that'll be a decision by the council, what we do moving forward. But, you know, we've had a lot of growth, and I think it's time to, my personal feeling is it's time to take a look at it and see what the impacts will be from that growth. And biggest thing is if you could stay engaged. If everybody could just stay engaged and feel free to call any of us. And I'm always happy to meet with my constituents at any time and answer their questions. I may not always know the answer, but I will try and find it for you and work with you. So it's we really appreciate hearing from you. Thank you.
Well, thank you so much for your thoughtful and varied questions. It's been really interesting to see what you're actually interested in. Just so you're aware, we have over 40 different topic lists that we send email and text notifications on, and we'd love for you to sign up on the topics that you're interested in. Jamie is in the back with the laptop. If you're interested, you can sign up tonight, or you can head over to the Goleta Valley Tech Center and just go on our website at www.cityofgoleta.org. We'd love to keep you informed about what's going on, and then you can further engage with us on those projects. I have three last announcements. The Goleta Library is looking for volunteers for a barcoding project. If you're interested, please talk to Allison. I know she'd love to hear from you. And we hope you'll mark your calendar for the 6th annual Dam Dinner on August 18th at Lake Los Carneros. It's a really fun time for our community to be together and just enjoy the good land. And actually, I already told you about the text and email notifications, so that's all. Those are my announcements. And we want to really thank you for taking the time tonight to attend the State of the City. This program will be rebroadcast in English and in Spanish on our City TV Channel 19. It will be posted on the website at cityofgoleta.org and on our YouTube channel. And again, if you have any further questions, please feel free to see one of us after the event. Thank you and have a great evening. Thank you.